الحمد لله إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها النبي قل لأزواجك إن كنتن تردن الحياة الدنيا وزينتها فتعالين أمتعكن وأسرحكن سراحا جميلا وإن كنتن تردن الله ورسوله والدار الآخرة فإن الله أعد للمحسنات منكن أجرا عظيما وقال النبي صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم الدنيا كلها متاع وخير المتاع المرأة الصالحة أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين Respected sisters and mothers in Islam, we find one of the elements by virtue of which the West and the media is portraying Islam to be an unpleasant religion and by virtue of which they have fakely succeeded in misguiding and beguiling many, many young girls has been the false image that they are portraying how Islam conducts women and the status that Islam affords to women. This is one of the weapons, one of the tools by virtue of which they are using it and propaganda is taking place contrary to what Islam has afforded this girl and how honorable and how sacred Islam has made her. If we have to analyze in a Western society what are the objectives and what are the ideals of a girl growing up in an environment of this nature, or be it South Africa or any other Western environment, then as that young girl grows up, she's constantly made to believe that if she can beautify herself and she can adorn herself and young men can get attracted to her, then many women unfortunately consider lustful gazes of strange men tantamount to respect. They regard it equal to honor and dignity and feel honorable about this lustful gazes. So many a times we find a girl that is growing up in this environment who has the compass of the dunya before her. These are her ideals, these are her objectives, and she tries to outdo one another, and thousands of pounds are spent in the cosmetic industry to beautify herself, to present herself. Now let's analyze the harms of following this pattern both from deen and dunya. We find girls that grow up in this way, whose objective is this, they hardly succeed in any marriage life, they cannot make any home, and this lustful contact breaks up, and she becomes a merchandise, so to say, that every man comes and abuses her, and in this way her life is ruined. From the Islamic perspective, the harms of a girl leading a life like this, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ النَّاظِرَ وَالْمَنْظُورِ إِلَيْهِ Allah's curse is upon that male who casts a lustful gaze at a strange female, and likewise Allah's curse is equally on that female who presents herself, who projects herself, who adorns herself and beautifies herself so that strange men can look at her. That woman who goes out with the intention of decorating herself before strange men, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that the curse of Allah is upon her. The riwayat of Muslim Sharif, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, صِنْفَانِ مِنْ أَهْلِ النَّارِ O my Sahaba, there are two groups that are destined for Jahannam which I haven't seen, but I'm prophesizing they come in. لَمْ أَرَهُمَا I have not seen them, but the ummah that is to come will observe it. قَوْمٌ مَعَهُمْ سِيَاتٌ كَأَذْنَابِ الْبَقَرِ وَنِسَاءٌ كَاسِيَاتٌ عَارِيَاتٌ مُمِيلَاتٌ مَائِلَاتٌ رُؤُوسُهُنَّ كَأَسْنِمَةِ الْبُخْتِ الْمَائِلَةِ لَا يَدْخُلْنَ الْجَنَّةَ وَلَا يَجِدْنَ رِيحَهَا وَإِنَّ رِيحَهَا لَتُوجَدُ مِنْ مَسِيرَةِ كَذَا وَكَذَا O my Sahaba, one is a group of women, nisa'un, kasiyatun, who will be dressing themselves, ariyat, but they will be wearing clothing which is totally transparent, mumilatun ma'ilatun, inclining towards men, and they themselves will be inclining towards men, attracting men with a seductive voice in their approach, in their sweet tone. And Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says the consequences of such a girl is so severe, لا يدخلن الجنة ولا يجدن ريحها such a female will not only be deprived of Jannat, but wallah, she will be also deprived of the fragrance of Jannat. Whereas the fragrance of Jannat would be enjoyed by a Jannati 500 years prior to coming close to Jannat. So we find this is the consequences of this girl. She will not have any stable condition in this world also. Her marriage will not succeed, and her consequences in Akhirat will be also very severe. Now what we need to analyze today, sisters, is understand that we have to look at our honor in the light of Quran and Hadith. What is my role as demonstrated by Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? This is a fake notion, and this is a false image that has been portrayed by the West, that we are not allowed to beautify ourselves. In fact, we have been encouraged, and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has actually given us targheeb. And not only targheeb, but the beauty of Islam is that when a woman adorns herself and beautifies herself and decorates herself, which is her natural desire as she becomes young and she matures, the natural instinct that Allah has created in her, it's human. Aisha radiallahu anha wears a beautiful garment and then she admires herself like any other woman would do. But immediately look at the reaction of her father. And this is the time where perhaps the elderly sisters, the mothers, those of us that have children, we have to understand what is our position, what is our role. One is the duty of a mother, and one is the duty of a Muslim mother. One is the duty of a father, and one is the duty of a Muslim father. One is the duty of a physician, and one is the duty of a Muslim physician. The duty of a mother is to see that my child eats. And alhamdulillah, you take a lot of pride in seeing that your child eats, which is wonderful, which is unique, which is the duty that follows with motherhood. And let me tell you, sister, on that also Allah is going to reward you so tremendously. The riwayat appears in Muslim Sharif. Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha says, one woman came begging to my house, and with her she has two daughters. Now we know Aisha radiallahu anha did not have children, and naturally a woman that is not a mother cannot understand truly the relation between mother and child, and the bond that Allah Ta'ala has created between the mother and child. Especially at the time when the mother is suckling her child. Here again, the West is teaching us of ways to substitute this, that we do not suckle our child. That is perhaps the closest bond that exists between any two humans is between the mother and the suckling child. Every time the child drinks milk, every time the child disturbs our sleep, on that great, great reward has been mentioned. What I want to stress today is that unfortunately the element of sawab, and the element of the awareness of what Allah has promised in our duties, today we have forgotten. So when I'm beautifying myself for my husband, I'm not realizing that this is ibadah. And wallah, I can safely say this. If you will beautify yourself for your husband to attract him so that my husband loves a modest life, and there is faithfulness, there is fidelity between myself and my husband, then safely we can say on that Allah will give you more reward than tahajjud namaz. If the Nabi of Allah says, it is not correct for you to engage in an optional fast until you do not seek the permission of your husband, then understand what is Islam affording you. Islam encourages you to do that which is your nature, which is your inherent quality, but restrict yourself to the confines of your house for the beauty of your husband. On that you will be fulfilling your own desire also, which is natural, and on that Allah will reward you greatly. I was mentioning the riwayat of Aisha radiallahu anha. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu looks at Aisha and he says, مَا تَنْظُرِينَ يَا عَيْشَ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِنَاظِرٍ إِلَيْكَ. Oh Aisha, I don't know what you are admiring about yourself, because Allah is not admiring you. Aisha, I don't know what you are looking at, Allah works. But in Aisha radiallahu anhu is a young girl. Imagine, but this is the beauty of deen. When deen comes into a girl, she will mature. I mentioned this back home also. When there's deen in a boy or in a girl, you will find that person will mature mentally and in every aspect of life. Allah Ta'ala will inspire that girl. She will become responsible. Aisha radiallahu anha is widowed at the age of 18. The Nabi of Allah passes away. The injunction of the Quran is, وَلَا أَن تَنْكِحُوا أَزْوَاجَهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ أَبَدًا إِنَّ ذَلِكُمْ كَانَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمًا. That it is not correct for the widow of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to remarry. We find after the demise of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam, one day Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam comes in the house, and then he whispers something to Fatima radiallahu anha, and then she starts crying. Then again he whispers something and then she smiles. So Aisha radiallahu anha went to Fatima and he said, I am not your mother, of course, but I am the mankuha of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I ask you, what secret was this between you and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Fatima radiallahu anha declined and she says, no, I will not share the secret with you. After that, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed away. So she went to Fatima radiallahu anha and she asked, what was the secret between you and Nabi alayhi salam? So Fatima radiallahu anha said, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told me that the time for me to leave this world has come very close. So in all human reaction, I started crying. When Nabi alayhi salam passed away, Fatima radiallahu anha said, سُبَّتْ عَلَيَّ مَصَائِبُ لَوْ أَنَّهَا سُبَّتْ عَلَى الْأَيَّامِ سِرْنَ لَيَالِيَا. Such a calamity has befallen me on the demise of my father. It's so weighty, it's so colossal, it's so mammoth. لَوْ أَنَّهَا سُبَّتْ عَلَى الْأَيَّامِ. If this catastrophe has to fall on the day, even the day doesn't have the ability to contain it, instantly it will be changed, it will be converted into night. يَا أَبَتَا أَتَابَ رَبًّا دَعَا. يَا أَبَتَا إِلَى جِبْرِيلَ نَنْعَا. يَا أَبَتَا جَنَّةُ الْفِرْدَوْسِ مَأْوَى. Oh my father, it looks like you've responded to the call of Jibreel. Oh my father, who can we say and who can we convey the message of your demise other than Jibreel alayhi salam? Oh my father, Jannatul Firdaus is your abode. This is what Nabi alayhi salam told me. Then he told me something in my ears for which I smiled. He told me, oh Fatima, you will be the first one to join me. And Nabi Karim Sasam told his wife that Asra'u kunna luhuqan bi atwalu kunna yadan. The first from amongst my wives to join me will be the one that has the longest hands. Aisha radiallahu anha says, after the demise of Nabi alayhi salam, we used to measure our hands. And physically we used to see whose hand was the longest. And we used to say, the one that has the longest hand will go and join Nabi alayhi salam first. It was only after we realized that Hazrat Safiya radiallahu anha, if I'm not mistaken, passed away. At that time we realized that the length of the hands denoted generosity. And it did not denote the physical length of the hand. Nevertheless, I was mentioning of the incident of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that when this woman came home and Aisha radiallahu anha took out the date, so Aisha radiallahu anha becomes a widow at the age of 18. She lived up to 50 years, half a century after the demise of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. It is not permissible for her to remarry. She is the narrator of 2,210 ahadith. At the age of 18, she had conveyed and contributed to the ummah so extensively that a significant amount of masail are extracted and deducted from the narrations of Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha. So this is the maturity that will come with deen. So she says, when the Nabi of Allah came home, I gave the 3 dates to the mother, one to the child and one to the other child. I observed a very strange practice. The mother gave one to this child, the child ate it, the other child ate it, and the mother was about to eat the 3rd date, and both the children looked at the mother with desire. So the mother split the date in half, and she gave half to one child and half to the other child, which is the duty of motherhood. And on this, Allah will reward you. And this is what we need to understand. We have to put the compass of akhirat before us. And let us start now analyzing our life with the ideals of deen, with the goals of deen. As a Muslim girl living in this environment, what does Allah want from me? And if I comply to this, and I design my life according to the objectives of Islam, what has Allah promised for me in this world? What has Allah promised for me in akhirat? Unfortunately, many of us have fallen prey to the propaganda of the kuffar, and many women subtly feel that yes, unfortunately, my options are restricted as a Muslim woman. But very ironically, we fail to comprehend that when that woman is smiling to a strange man on a flight and presents a platter of food to a strange boy with a smile, then she is progressive and she is liberated and she is modern and she is exploring and she is experiencing. Yet when that very same woman, with honor, with respect, with dignity, presents the platter of food to her husband with a smile and to her child with a smile, then she is backwards, then she is restricted, then she is deprived. And on that, the Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has promised. Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam comes home. So Aisha radiallahu anha says, O Nabi of Allah, I observe this strange practice. The woman, I gave the 3 dates, she gives one to one child, one to the other, and she's about to have the 3rd one, and the children look with desire, she splits it half-half. Nabi alayhi salam says, لَقَدْ دَخَلَتْ بِذَٰلِكَ الْجَنَّةِ. Aisha, I make you my witness because of this trivial kindness of the mother to her daughters, where she foregoed her own rights. She did not eat the date and she divided it in half for both her daughters. Allah be my witness, on this action, Jannat has become compulsory for this mother. So this is what Allah is going to give you on the duty of motherhood. But as I mentioned, there's an additional responsibility, and that is the duty of a Muslim mother. The duty of a Muslim mother will be, the duty of the mother is that my child must eat. And we get up, we delay our sleep, we make sure the child eats. If the child has eaten, then mentally we are released. The duty of a Muslim mother is that my child must not eat until he doesn't take Allah's name. So until my child doesn't take Allah's name, he's not going to eat. The duty of a father is, I must make sure that before I leave for work, adequate arrangements have been made for the study of my son. But the duty of a father will be that my son must not go to school, college or university until he does not commence his day by bowing and prostrating before Allah. The duty of a physician will be that when he walks into my surgery, in the interest of my knowledge, I prescribe the best medication for him. But the duty of a Muslim physician will be, when he walks out of my surgery, he must have more reliance on the cure of Allah than on my prescription. So we find, my sisters, on the duty that Allah Ta'ala has given upon us here, that when we will play this role and we will demonstrate the role that Allah Ta'ala wants from us, growing up in that environment and keeping the objectives of Akhirat before us. So when we will be kind, when we will feed our children, Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says there is Jannat. Then Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, the best person, الدنيا كلها متاع, this world in its entirety is something from which a man benefits. وخير المتاع, and perhaps the best thing from which any human can benefit, المرأة الصالحة, a pious girl. Now who is a pious girl? إن نظر إليها سرته, when her husband looks at her, then it brings joy to him. It brings joy to him. In Jamul Fawaid, the riwayat appears, Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, أَعْظَمُ الْحَقِّ عَلَى الرَّجُلِ أُمُّهُ وَأَعْظَمُ الْحَقِّ عَلَى الْمَرْأَةِ زَوْجُهَا. The greatest right upon a male is his duty towards his mother, and the greatest right upon a girl is her duty towards her husband. We find very commonly it happens, I mentioned this in the talks also, where we find there's a bit of an antagonistic relation that is between the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law, which many a times jeopardizes the position of the innocent husband. He's been, twisted, and he's been pulled from both sides. One side he's trying to make his mother happy, one side he's trying to make his wife happy. In between there's a child. But unfortunately, because of pressure from both sides, and each party impressing on her own personal view, makes the life of this husband so difficult. If we have to really look at this from an Islamic angle, then we find this relation, if we capitalize on it and we value it and we appreciate it, it can be the means of securing Jannat for husband and wife. If not, otherwise, if we will abuse it, it will be the means of us destroying our Jannat. So the wife is told by her husband that serve my mother and make her happy. Definitely I acknowledge you are obligated to me and you are not obligated to my mother. You have got married to me and you are contracted to me. But understand, oh my wife, this is my mother. Because of her I have come in this world. Nabi alayhi salam says my obligation to her is the greatest. If you will serve my mother, don't wait for a thanks from my mother, for an appreciation from my mother. Here again, unfortunately, it's tragic that whatever good the daughter-in-law will contribute, it becomes very difficult for the mother-in-law to say a polite word, to say a jazakallah, to appreciate. But constantly we see the flaws of our daughter-in-law. Constantly we pick out the wrong of our daughter-in-law. We find it very difficult to appreciate their contribution. And because of this, we are making life difficult for ourselves. If this girl will respect her mother-in-law to earn the du'as of her husband, the husband should be kind enough to appreciate what he does for his mother. When this girl will do to please her husband, she will be kind to her mother-in-law, respect her, then the husband will be happy. If the husband is happy, then this woman's Jannat is secured. If the mother is happy, the husband's Jannat is secured. So if we will, adhere to the teachings of Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then we will find our stay in this world will become a pleasure. Let's take the example of Umm Sulaym radiallahu ta'ala anha. You show me of one girl graduating from any academic institution that can come in the house and display such a magic role and such a matured role. It's typical, we are living in a situation where daily there are problems, there are challenges, there are difficulties. Every person is going through difficulties. Perhaps today you got married, it's happiness, it's joy, it's prosperity. But that's not the order of life. Life will change, halat will come and change. My honorable father always says that marriage is like the weather. Sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cold, sometimes it's snowing, sometimes it's raining. And at times in one day you have four seasons. And at times it's raining for few days and you think the sun will never rise and the future looks bleak, but then the sun comes out. And sometimes it's sunny for few days. So this is the nature of marriage life. It's unpredictable. But really, if we can govern our lives with the dictates of Shariat, then every one of us will return home. You will anticipate the coming of your husband with such joy, just as that newly wed couple are going to meet for the first day. If we can discipline ourselves and we can bring some guidelines in our lives, let's take the incident of Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha. Abu Talha and Umm Sulaym, husband and wife, great sahaba. There is a sick child at home. Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha is taking care of the child. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu is equally concerned. The riwayat appears in Bukhari Sharif. Allahu Akbar. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu goes out to work. When he comes home, naturally the first concern is about his child. While the husband is gone out, in the absence of the husband, the child passes away. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Now this is what I want to draw your attention to. Look at how mature this woman is. Wallah, I marvel. And it's mind-boggling, you know, to comprehend or even to endeavor to comprehend the capability of this woman, the steadfastness of this woman, the foresight of this woman, the perseverance of this woman. She understands her duty as a woman in the house. She arranges for the ghusl of the child. She arranges for the kafan of the child. She is a mother. You will understand, oh my mother, what is the level of love that a mother has for a child. I definitely agree, and I fully agree, the love of a mother is unique. It's unparalleled. There's nothing compared to that. And that love comes out of the pain you have experienced in bearing that child, in delivering that child. And this is how the system of Allah Ta'ala is, that by virtue of that pain, that love is transmitted in the heart of the mother for the child. So you cannot tell me that this mother did not feel hurt at the separation of her child. Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is crying. He's crying at the janazah of Ibrahim radiallahu anhu. Abdurrahman ibn Auf is present. So he says, O Nabi of Allah, what are these tears? We are weak. We will cry if we lose our child. What is it that you are crying? Mawlana Ibrahim Dawla Damat Markatuhum mentioned, Subhanallah, huquq bi batlaye, hudud bi batlaye. Nabi alayhi salam showed us the rights of the child also and showed us the limits also. The rights of the child is, Nabi alayhi salam said, Inna al-ayna tadma. وَالْقَلْبُ يَحْزُنُ وَلَا نَقُولُ إِلَّا مَا يَرْضَى بِهِ رَبُّنَا. Nabi alayhi salam cried and he said, this is the right of the child. As a father, if I will not cry when I have lost my child, then who will cry? As a mother, if you will not cry, who will cry? This is the right, this is the duty, this is the obligation to that child. So this is the right. But then there are limits. What are the limits? وَلَا نَقُولُ إِلَّا مَا يَرْضَى بِهِ رَبُّنَا. But I will restrict my tongue to utter in only that with which my Allah is pleased, and that is Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha arranges for the ghusl of this child. When Abu Talha radiallahu anhu comes home, Allahu Akbar. Now let us see how this woman receives her husband. One is that girl who goes out in the environment. Many a times girls ask this question, that no, I'm pursuing a degree for the simple reason that if my husband does not earn sufficiently, I can supplement the income of the house by earning also. My sisters, Nabi Kareem Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says in the hadith, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّ عَبْدِي بِي. I will treat my servant as my servant considers me. If you will venture into a marriage and you will pursue a degree with the aim that my husband cannot provide for me, then Allah will put you in that condition that your husband's income will not be sufficient for you and you will have to earn. When you will earn, it will open up a can of worms and a host of problems. The Quran says, الرِّجَالُ قَوَّامُونَ عَلَى النِّسَاءِ بِمَا فَضَّلَ اللَّهُ بَعْضَهُمْ عَلَى بَعْضٍ وَبِمَا أَنفَقُوا مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. Allah has given certain form of superiority. Now when we say superiority, not in an abusive relation, not that the husband is in authority to be harsh to his wife, but rather Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يَغْلِبُهُمْ لَئِيمٌ يَغْلِبُهُمْ لَئِيمٌ. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describing, يَغْلِبْنَ كَرِيمًا يَغْلِبْنَ كَرِيمًا وَيَغْلِبُهُنَّ لَئِيمٌ فَأُحِبُّ أَنْ أَكُونَ كَرِيمًا مَغْلُوبًا وَلَا أُحِبُّ أَنْ أَكُونَ لَئِيمًا غَالِبًا. Nabi alayhi salam defining the nature and the temperament of a woman says, يَغْلِبْنَ كَرِيمًا. They will overpower and dominate a soft man. This is the nature of woman as Nabi alayhi salam outlines it. If the man is soft and gentle and passive, then the wife will overpower him. وَيَغْلِبُهُنَّ لَئِيمٌ. And a stern and a harsh and a rigid man, he will overpower his wife. With regards to me, O my Sahaba, فَأُحِبُّ أَنْ أَكُونَ كَرِيمًا مَغْلُوبًا. I wish to be soft and gentle and overpowered by my wife than to be harsh and arrogant and overrule her. If we have to study and analyze the social life of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and this is the way we've got to raise our daughters. Let her understand that this is what you've got to do. You know, so much time is invested in the trousseau shopping of that girl, in her preparation, in this and that, that she doesn't understand what which mind frame she's got to venture into marriage. Then again, our very marriage structure is not very stable that we can demonstrate practically a good moral to the girl that is growing up in the house, where what, you know, how do we conduct it, both from the husband and the wife. Nevertheless, Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha arranges for the ghusl, Allahu Akbar. Abu Talha comes home in the evening. Now let us ask ourselves, what is our situation? Is something, and perhaps not janazah, something much more trivial, much more insignificant, something went wrong at home, some harm came to particular situation at home, some difficulty, stove not working, lights went out, or something happened in the absence of our husband. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu comes home. Allahu Akbar. Umm Sulaym radiallahu anhu receives him with a smile. The first question the husband asks, how is my son? So Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha uses an ambiguous term, and she says, huwa askanu mimma kan. He is more peaceful than what he was. She doesn't say he has recovered, nor does she say he has passed away, but she understands my husband is tired, he is hungry, perhaps he has a physical need. What role do I have to display at this time? And this is what I implore you to take as your message, O my sister, and understand on this what is the reward that Allah has promised for you. Wallahi, Islam is that beautiful religion that in every form of contact between husband and wife, to enhance the relation, to better the relation, the Nabi of Allah has even given permission to speak a lie to your wife to make her happy. Just to better the relation. That, yes, oh my beloved. Nabi alayhi salam says, in everything that you do, putting the morsel in her mouth, it is sawab. Unfortunately, we terminate these practices 2 weeks after we married. 3 weeks after we married, we terminate it. And when we terminate it, then what happens is the husband, unfortunately, is smiling with strange woman outside. So by the time he comes home, his muscles are tired to smile when his wife is anxiously awaiting him. His facial muscles doesn't want to smile, and he's abrupt, he's snobbish, when that woman is awaiting him with respect and dignity. Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha says, no, he is in more peace than what he was. The husband positively interpreting it as recovery. تقدمت إليه العشاء. She then presents a platter of food. Allahu Akbar. That, oh my husband, you are hungry, here's the food. The husband comes in, he sits down, he eats. Subhanallah, it doesn't end here. تصنعت له. She then adorns herself. She beautifies herself. Like perhaps the groom, the bride would beautify herself on her first night. Allah alone knows what is going through the heart of that woman. But yet she doesn't reveal it. She doesn't express it. She contains herself. Allah knows what reward Allah is going to give this woman. And this is the role that the Western are not ready to accept. This is the honor that Allah has given this girl. Now when she's going to go out to work, all these objectives will be forfeited. All these objectives will be neglected. But rather she'll walk into a house where those children will be fed, or they won't be fed. They will be neglected. لَيْسَ الْيَتِيمُ مَنْ انْتَهَى إِلَيْهِ أَبَوَاهُ مِنْ هَمِّ الْحَيَاةِ وَخَلَّفَاهُ ذَلِيلًا. The poet says, I don't believe that the child who is left without parents is the only orphan in the world. He is one orphan, the entire world has sympathized on him. The poet says, I'm telling you of another orphan, and he is that child who enjoys the presence of his biological parents, but both of them are engaged in pursuit of material gain, and they neglect the upbringing of the child. The poet says, I implore you that you focus on this child. This child is an equal orphan, and he also needs your love and your sympathy. That he grows up in a house where the mother's object is different, the father's object is different. Really, those parents will be responsible who have made desires to have children. It came through the command of Allah, and then have neglected. كَفَى بِالْمَرْءِ إِثْمًا أَن يُضَيِّعَ مَنْ يَقُودُ. The riwayat of Abu Dawud says, Nabi alayhi salam says, if the husband does not present a platter of food before his wife and before his children, then he is a criminal in the eyes of Allah. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam says, dinarun anfaqtahu fi sabilillah. In the riwayat of Muslim Sharif, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu is the narrator. One is that pound that you spend in the path of Allah. Dinarun tasaddaqta bihi ala miskin. One is the pound you spend on a poor person. Dinarun anfaqtahu ala raqaba. One is the pound you spend on the freedom and the emancipation of a slave. Dinarun anfaqtahu ala ahlik. And one is the pound you spend on the need of your wife. A'zamuha ajran alladhi anfaqtahu ala ahlik. The pound that will bring you the closest to Allah is the money you spend and invested on the need of your wife and children. Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha then decorates herself. This woman is understanding that. The woman that is working in the outside environment, the children are neglected. She comes in the house. Naturally, because she is earning, now she is on an equal standard in the house. She's not going to respect her husband. In fact, the husband will be more obligated to her because she will be contributing to the expenses of the house. So the whole situation of what Allah has planned has now been reversed. Now the husband will be, as I mentioned, the Quran says that Allah has given the man a certain... The first reason is, as I mentioned, not in an abusive relation. This is what the West are harping on. that the woman is victimized. Wallah, she has more honor in our house. She is more respected. At no stage will we risk her honor. We would prefer her to sit indoors. One of the other aspects, just for you to understand, sister, is that many a times you are made to believe that in the legacy you have half while the male enjoys double. You might perhaps think that Islam, na'udhu billah, is gender biased and Islam is biased against the female. No, no, get the perspective correct. Understand it correctly and pass the correct message to your daughter. The reason why Allah has given you half, لِلذَّكَرِ مِثْلُ حَظِّ الْأُنْثَيَيْنِ, analyze the position of a girl from the time she comes in this world till the time she dies. At no stage in her life is she responsible to earn for herself, never mind anyone else. She is the duty of her father. If her father, she gets married, she is the duty of her husband. She, if her husband is late, she is the duty of her son if she has mature sons. If there isn't a son, she is the duty of her brother. And wallahi, if there's nobody around her, the national treasury of the Muslim Ummah will take responsible to provide for that widow, to provide for that woman. But at no stage will we risk her outside, her honor, where she is vulnerable and she is exposed and she has to go into the cosmetic industry to earn few pounds, neglect her life, risk her izzat. No, no, she is too precious to us. Ya ukhti, la tarfa'i anki al-khimara fatanjami. Suni jamalaki in aratki karama. Oh my sister, for Allah's sake, don't unveil yourself if you want to enjoy the honor of akhirat. Suni jamalaki, protect your beauty, keep your beauty exclusively for your husband. And when do you display it? Display it like Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha. The plate of food is presented. Abu Talha consumes the meal. She then decorates herself. She beautifies herself. She presents herself. It is natural as a man, especially for a man exposed to an environment like this. We fail to understand the reward that Allah has promised. Perhaps the reward on beautifying yourself and using a sweet tone to speak to your husband, to attract your husband, to satisfy your need of the husband, Allah will give you more reward than nafil salah. Allah will give you more reward than engaging in nafil amal. Because this is the objective. لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. What is the fundamental object of nikah? Allah says, so that tranquility transpires between husband and wife, between spouse and spouse. There is happiness, there is joy, there is bliss, there is a shoulder, there is support. وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And mawadda and rahma, that is kindness and mercy. This particular quality between husband and wife is expressed generally at a later stage of life, where generally they overcome the human need, the physical need, and now it's more the companionship. Now it's more being close to one another and encouraging one another, supporting another. So this is the fundamental objectives of nikah. If this is not being achieved in our marriages, and this is not the message we are imparting and disseminating to our daughters, then we have failed in our duties as mothers. She decorates herself. Abu Talha radiallahu anhu then has relation. And after he had relation with his partner, فَلَمَّا رَأَتْ أَنْ شَبِعَ. Allahu Akbar. Allah gives jazai khair to Umm Sulaym radiallahu anha. Allah rewarded the best that he has rewarded anyone on behalf of anyone. Allah elevate her stages in Jannah. What a role model. You show me one woman in the entire world that can display such a unique, such a matured role, that understands. One side, the janaza of her son is lying in a house. The riwayat appears in Bukhari Sharif. فَلَمَّا رَأَتْ, when the woman had seen, أَنْ شَبِعَ, that my husband is saturated, his physical need has been taken care of, now he is over, he ate also, he had relation with me also. And then she approaches him in a polite way and she says, oh Abu Talha, أَرَأَيْتَ لَوْ أَنَّ قَوْمًا أَعَارُوا عَارِيَتَهُمْ. Tell me, oh my beloved, can I ask you a question? Go for it. What's it, oh my beloved wife? What is it? Tell me. Especially at this time, when the husband has been received so well. Allahu Akbar. Wallahi, if a woman receives a husband with joy and anticipation, with obligation and respect, she has the potential of taking away the tiredness, the frustration, and the fatigue of the entire day. But if she receives him with complaints, تَصَدَّقْنَا يَا مَعْشَرَ النِّسَاءِ, the riwayat of Bukhari, oh, the group of women, give charity in abundance. فَإِنِّي رَأَيْتُكُنَّ أَكْثَرَ أَهْلِ النَّارِ. I found that Jahannam is greatly occupied by you. بِمَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Why us, O Nabi of Allah? تَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرِ. تُكْثِرْنَا اللَّغْنَ وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرِ. You have two problems in you, the riwayat of Bukhari Sharif. What is it, O Nabi of Allah? One is you curse very often. Your tongue is very loose. You blame very quickly. You accuse very quickly. You verbally accuse people. It is so nasty to speak ill of women. The Quran makes special mention about this here. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا يَسْخَرْ قَوْمٌ مِّن قَوْمٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُونُوا خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا نِسَاءٌ مِّن نِّسَاءٍ عَسَىٰ أَن يَكُنَّ خَيْرًا مِّنْهُمْ وَلَا تَلْمِزُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَلَا تَنَابَزُوا بِالْأَلْقَابِ. O you who believe, لا يسخر قوم من قوم. Let not one group mock or scoff or laugh or belittle another group. Then Allah makes special mention about woman. ولا نساء من نساء. And let not one girl, one young girl, one woman laugh at another girl. Consider her to be insignificant. Who knows the one you are laughing at perhaps enjoys a senior rank in the eyes of Allah. One day Aisha radiallahu anha made an unpleasant comment regarding Safiya. حسبك من صفية كذا وكذا تعني قصيرة. O Nabi of Allah, your wife Safiya, she is short. What's so good about her? Nabi alayhi salam said, Aisha, I love you and you are beloved to me and you are the daughter of Abu Bakr. Wallahi لقد قلت كلمة. But today you have uttered such a despicable statement, such an unpleasant statement. If that statement has to be given a liquid form and it is diluted in the water of the world, لَنَجَسَتِ الْبَحْرُ. Wallahi, it has the potential of contaminating and polluting the water of the entire world. So what will happen when our Fatima and our Aisha will say this here? When the Aisha of Nabi alayhi salam said this was the condition, Safiya radiallahu anha. Safiya radiallahu anha is the daughter of Huyay bin Akhtab. Huyay bin Akhtab was a Yahud. So Safiya radiallahu anha had a Jewish origin. So sometimes there was a bit of unpleasantness amongst the wives. At the fatal illness of Nabi alayhi salatu was salam, when he's lying in his maradul wafat and all the wives surround him, so Safiya radiallahu anha stood by Nabi alayhi salatu was salam and he said, O Nabi of Allah, Allah is my witness, I wish I was experiencing your pain and you were in my place of comfort. So the other wives made nasty comments and they started winking eyes, said, look at this one here, what's her comment now? She's trying to show she's better than us. Nabi alayhi salam observed this. He said, go on winking eyes and say what you want to. By Allah, I know Safiya is speaking the truth. I know my Safiya is speaking the truth. فَلَمَّا رَأَتْ. When Umm Sulaym seen that Abu Talha's need was catered for and was saturated, he said, tell me my beloved, أَرَأَيْتَ لَوْ أَنَّ قَوْمًا أَعَارُ عَارِيَتَهُمْ. Tell me if someone borrows you an article and they tell you to use it after the time has left and the time is over and they claim that article back, do you have the right to refuse and decline? So he answers in the negative, no, I cannot. I mean, if I borrowed something from someone in due time, when the time expires, the owner has the authority of claiming back. So he asked his wife, but what are you getting to? I mean, what's the relation of what are you asking? She says, okay, my husband, let me pat you on the back. And she embraces him and she says, احتسب عند الله, hope for tawab. Our son was an amanat from Allah. Allah has taken him back. Allahu Akbar. Immediately he burst into tears. And then he tells his wife, you left me till I started drowning in my desire. You know, I went deep down in my lust and my passion and you left me. Immediately he runs to Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He narrates the entire ordeal and the entire incident to Nabi alayhi salam. Nabi alayhi salam says, أَعَرَّسْتُمُ اللَّيْلَ. Did you have relation last night? Yes, O Nabi of Allah, we had relation. بَارَكَ اللَّهُ فِي لَيْلَتِكُمَا. Allah has given barakat in the last night conception. In that last night, conception took place and Uyayna ibn Hisn, who is the Rawi of the Hadith, says a child was born by the name of Abdullah and this child grew up to become the father of 9 sons, every one of whom was a Hafiz and Alim of Deen. One woman comes to Nabi alayhi salam, Ya Rasulallah, هذا الجهاد كتبه الله على الرجال فإن أصيبوا أجروا وإن قتلوا كانوا أحياء ونحن معشر النساء نقوم عليهم فما لنا من ذلك. O Nabi of Allah, you have ordained jihad for the men. They strive in the path of Allah. I want to first mention that one hadith. Nabi alayhi salam says there are two problems. تُكْثِرْنَ اللَّعْنَ وَتَكْفُرْنَ الْعَشِيرِ. One is you curse very quickly and the other thing is you are ungrateful to the favor of your husband. لَوْ أَحْسَنْتَ إِلَىٰ إِحْدَاهُنَّ الدَّهْرَ. If one of your husband is kind to you for dahr, dahr means a decade. Decade means 10 years. ثُمَّ رَأَتْ فِيكَ الشَّيْعَ. And then one day, your husband does something contrary to your desire. What do you say? مَا رَأَيْتُ فِيكَ خَيْرًا قَتُّ. Since the day I got married to you, I never seen good in you. You will point to your husband with the rings that he bought for you and wearing the bangles that he purchased for you and you will say, you have bought nothing for me. You have done nothing for me. Wearing his clothes, wearing his jewelry, and you will say, he has done nothing for me. This is what Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said. I am not mentioning that the husbands are innocent. Just that it's a gathering of females, that is why I'm addressing that angle. Otherwise, the husbands also need to be tolerant. One person came to Umar radiallahu anhu. He had a problem that his wife used to beg answer him. So as he gets to the door of Umar, سَمِعَ زَوْجَتَهُ أُمُّ كُلْثُومٍ تَطَاوَلَتْ عَلَيْهِ. He heard the wife of Umar beg answer in Umar radiallahu anhu. And subhanAllah, this was the nature. We have to study the lives. Unfortunately, we are looking at those women who have no morals, who have no values, who are displaying themselves in front of the world, who are public figures, who have no haya, who have no izzat. So the husband wants the wife to dress like that. The wife wants the husband to dress in a different way. And constantly we are being bombarded with the images of dunya, trying to imitate them. There's no more pleasure left in this life. The husband comes home, there's no joy. The wife is not happy to meet the husband. There's no fidelity, there's no loyalty, there's no sukoon, there's no mawadda, there's no rahmah. So Umar radiallahu, he heard Umar radiallahu back answering his wife. Umar radiallahu's wife back answering Umar. He heard this and he excused himself and he went away. Umar radiallahu anhu heard someone came to the door. He opened the door. He said, "Bhai, come inside. What's the problem?" He says, "No, Umar, I wanted to tell you that my wife back answers me, but with utmost respect to you, I think you are also in the same boat. We're sailing on one boat, so I don't think it's right for me to ask you this problem." Umar radiallahu anhu says, "No, come here, come here. Inni atajawazu anha lihuquqin laha alayya." Yes, maybe my wife has this problem. So what's wrong? Maybe generally the woman has it. But come, I tell you how I look at this problem. And I marvel at this here. Allah's Qasam, I tell it to myself, and I mention it to my wife, and I mention it in other programs. The Nabi of Allah receives revelation. Subhanallah. Ajeeb. He is crowned with Nabuwat. He becomes the master of both the worlds. When he comes home, he doesn't come home as a Nabi to his wife Khadija. He doesn't come and say, "Khadija, do you know who I am? You know how lucky you are, Khadija? I am the Nabi of Allah. I am the final prophet. The Quran is to be revealed on me." He says, "Zammiluni, Zammiluni. Khadija, something drastic went in my life. Come and cover me. I don't know what's going to happen to me." Then the wife praises her. Allahu Akbar. The first person to support Nabi Karim Sassam was his wife. And this is the most delicate part where unfortunately men fail. He can convince the woman across the road, his neighbor, those that are working with him. But as men, unfortunately, we fail to display that akhlaq where we can convince our own wives on the teachings of Nabi Karim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nabi alayhi salam never entered his house min haythun Nabi, as a professional person, as a Nabi, as the favored of Allah. He entered into his house as an ordinary person. What akhlaq does he display? Umar radiallahu anhu says, "Yes, maybe my wife back answers me, but I overlook this wrong of my wife because of the major favors. Sitrun baini wa bainan nar fa yaskunu biha qalbi anil haram." That my wife is a veil between me and Jahannam. And it is because of my wife that alhamdulillah I have been safeguarded from zina. Perhaps if it wasn't for my wife, there wouldn't be a girl that would cross my side, but that I will cast a nasty glance upon her. It is my wife that has kept my heart and my mind clean, that has given me the ability to engage in ibadat. When my wife has such a favor upon me that she has veiled me from Jahannam, I think I am duty bound to her. And it's just but correct that I tolerate and I persevere and I resist and I am tolerant in her verbal words. Tabakhatun khabbazatun. She cooks my food. She says to my children. When this man heard this, he melted into tears and he said, "Oh Umar, if this is your approach, all the more I should maintain the same approach with my wife." So the Nabi of Allah says, "Tukthirna al-la'na wa takfurna al-ashir." That you are ungrateful to your husband. "Law ahsanta ila ihdahunna ad-dahra, thumma ra'at fika shay'an, qalat ma ra'aytu fika khayran qattu." Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam says, "Al-mar'atu idha sallat khamsaha." When this woman will perform her salah, "wa samat sahraha," and pass in Ramadan, "wa ata'at ba'laha," and comply to her husband, "faltadkhul ayya abwabil jannati sha'at." The choice will be hers. She can enter from any door of Jannah that she wants to. So my sisters, let us see how we make preparations in this regard. We make our home an environment that is conducive for deen. Nabi alayhi salam calls his daughter Fatima in the riwayat of Bukhari, "Ya Fatima, salini ma shi'ti min mali, la ughni anki min Allahi shay'a." Oh my daughter Fatima, Nabi alayhi salam loved Fatima radiallahu anha. Fatima is part of me. Man ahabbaha faqad ahabbani. Whoever loves Fatima loves me. Wa man aadaha faqad aadani. And whoever has hurt Fatima has hurt me. Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu proposes to the daughter of Abu Jahl. Fatima radiallahu anha tells Nabi alayhi salam, "People say that you don't get offended for your daughter. Your son-in-law Ali, that is my husband, wants to get married to the daughter of Abu Jahl." Nabi alayhi salam ascends the pulpit. يصعد المنبر then he gives the خطبة and then he says لا أحلل حراما ولا أحرم حلالا. I am in no authority to make something lawful unlawful, neither do I reserve the authority of making something unlawful lawful. If Ali wants to get married to the daughter of Abu Jahl, a polygamy, restricted polygamy in Islam is permissible. It is his choice, it is his prerogative. However, I just want to say something on behalf of my daughter Fatima. I don't think the daughter of Abu Jahl and the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam can share one roof. That was his love for Fatima. Yet he says, Fatima, ask me whatever you want from my dunya, you can have it. But don't remain in this deception and delusion that because you are the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there will be no hisab for you. Fatima, your hisab will be separate, my hisab will be separate. Fatima, your account will be separate, my account will be separate. My sisters, let us make the tarbiyat of our daughters in this regard. Let us make our environment that is conducive to deen, that we become deserving of this. Nabi alayhi salam says that female will enter into Jannah from whichever way she wants to. Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam was asked by that woman, Allahu Akbar, I recited the ayat in the beginning, time has left, we've got to move on also. Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu, qul li azwajika وَبَنْ يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ قُلْ لِأَزْوَاجِكَ إِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا وَزِينَتَهَا فَتَعَالَيْنَ. The wives of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to Nabi alayhi salatu wa salam and they were complaining. They said, O Nabi of Allah, the other wives, they have beautiful homes, they have beautiful garments, they have beautiful this. We being your wives, the spouses and the partners of the master of both the world, we don't have anything. There's poverty in our house, there's penury in our house, there's difficulty, there's hardship in our house. So Nabi alayhi salam was very, very hurt. This caused a lot of pain to him, a lot of distress to him. And he left his wives for 1 month. In the interim, Sahaba got very worried. Umar radiallahu anhu came home, he admonished Hafsa, what have you done? He went to Nabi alayhi salam, have you divorced your wives? For 1 month, Nabi alayhi salam did not come close to his wives. And then Allah revealed the verse, Ayatul Takhir, the verse of option. That O Nabi of Allah, gather your wives, call them together. And tell every one of them, إِن كُنْتُنَّ تُرِدْنَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا أو عَيْسَى بِنْتِ أَبِي بَكَرْ أو حَفْسَى بِنْتِ عُمَرْ. If you want the wealth of this world, Allah says He will give you, and not how much you want, He will give you more than you want. But today your nikah with my Nabi terminates. From today you are no more the wife of my Nabi. You will no more have this honor. We will give you the world more than you want. The concluding verses of the 21st juz of the Quran, Surah Ahzab. Surah Ahzab speaks a lot about the ahkam of woman. Nabi alayhi salatu was salam calls them, calls Aisha radiallahu anha, oh Aisha, don't hasten. Allah has revealed the verse. You people ask me, you want better curtains. In the Ashiya of Jalalain, the request of every wife has been mentioned there also, on the authority of Sawi. If you want better curtains and you want better clothes, then oh Aisha, don't hasten. My Allah said He will give you more than what you want, but from today our relation terminates. Aisha radiallahu anha said, oh Nabi of Allah, I don't want this world. قَدْ اخْتَرْتُ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. I want you and I want Allah. And I will never ever ask you about the things of this dunya. Nabi alayhi salam said, no, go consult with your father. Aisha radiallahu anha says, أَفِيكَ أُشَاوِرُ أَبَوَيَّ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهُ. O Nabi of Allah, am I going to stoop so low? Am I going to be so foolish to consult? I want you and I want you and that's it. But don't tell the other wives my answer. Nabi alayhi salam then calls Hafsa radiallahu anha. And every wife answers, no, O Nabi of Allah, forgive us. We will never present the request of this world. After that, it is written in the Ashiya of Jalalain, Allah then cleansed the heart of the wives of Sahaba from the desire of this world. That a time came in the era of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, that he sends 80,000 dirhams in the presence of the mother of the entire ummah, Sayyidatina Aisha radiallahu anha. He tells the slave girl to distribute. At the time of iftar, there wasn't one date to break the fast. So my mothers and sisters, in conclusion, let us keep the compass of Akhirat before us. Let us keep the objectives of Akhirat. Let us keep the goals of Akhirat. Let us bring modesty into our life. Let us bring haya into our life. Haya, modesty, bashfulness. That is the beauty of a woman. Let us decorate ourselves with the haya of Islam. Such haya was present in the time of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are numerous incidents that Allah Ta'ala speaks about how modest, how bashful, with so much haya did the woman of Islam possess. We find the Quran makes mention about this here. Today immorality has become so common, immorality, indecency. وَيَنْهَا عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغِيِ. Allah prohibits immorality and less of haya, this modest approach. الحياء شعبة من الإيمان. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says haya is a significant branch of iman. May Allah Ta'ala inspire us all, and may Allah Ta'ala safeguard our daughters that are growing up in this environment. Now I was in America in the month of Ramadan, so we conducted a lot of ladies programs. Many a times the girls ask, Shaykh, why is it not permissible for us to put? Or one girl asked, Shaykh, where is it in the Quran that we cannot put nail polish? Prove, give me proof from the Quran. You know, these are the influences that we are getting. And this is all the effect of what is coming from outside. But if we will uphold the beauty of Islam, and we will understand our objectives and our limits are that which Islam has given us, and we will respect our husband, and we will be loving to our children, and we will make that house, one woman, Allah has the potential of nurturing that entire family, binding that entire family, molding and shaping that entire family. وَالْأُمُّ مَدْرَسَةٌ إِذَا أَعْدَدْتَهَا. The mother is an institution. If you have prepared that mother, and you have designed that mother, wallah, an institution has been prepared. Behind every successful man is the definite contribution of a woman. Every successful man, study the life of any person here. Study the lives of the wives of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam. I urge you, I implore you, I earnestly request you, study the social life of Nabi alayhi salam. And I would equally encourage the husbands for us to see the tolerant nature of Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In our home, there is a small problem, something much more trivial. The wife won't cook. There will be no, you know, relation. Imagine in the house of Abu Talha, the janaza of his son is lying. Yet the compliance and devotion from this woman binds this marriage. And in that, Allah Ta'ala blesses them with another child. وَأَمَّا الْغُلَامُ فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَشِينَا. If we will not give our children the correct deen, Allah speaks in the incident of Khidr alayhi salam, that Khidr slaughters that child. Someone perhaps might interpret this as harshness, that what was the crime of this child? But Allah says, فَكَانَ أَبَوَاهُ مُؤْمِنَيْنِ فَخَشِينَا أَن يُرِهِقَهُمَا تُغْيَانًا وَكُفْرًا. That the parents were pious, but because of the love that the parents had for the child, Allah says, we feared the child was going to influence the parents into disbelief. We were the child, as the child was going to grow up with modern ideas, the child was going to involve his influence onto the parents. Allah, out of his kindness, took that child before he matured, making Jannat wajib for the child and those parents. May Allah Ta'ala inspire us all and instill within our mothers and sisters haya and modesty, and make the objectives of Islam our ideals and our goals. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.